Yeah, are you ready?
Yep.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Alfreda Hall, and lead for NASA Commercial SmallSat Data Acquisition Program. And we are welcoming you to our lunch and learn session, in which we have a presentation on the DESIS data. And if you have any questions, we recommend that you put that in the chat. We'll try to get to those. That's basically the logistics. And I'll turn this back over to Yvonne or Heath. It doesn't matter.
Thanks, Alfreda. And again, thanks everyone for joining today's call. Today, we will be discussing DESIS data as well as TCloud. And for today's presentation, we have Heath Lesser and Cara Birch. Take it away, Heath.
All right, thanks, Yvonne, Alfreda. Hello, everyone, welcome to the lunch and learn to talk about TCloud and DESIS data. I really appreciate you taking time out and having interest in this topic. So we'll go ahead and get started. So I'll just kind of give an outline of what we're going to be talking about today. We'll briefly show you some of the DESIS team members that you may interact with or hear their names at some point. Talk about a little bit about the MUSES and DESIS hardware board station, capabilities, specifications, things of that nature. Then we'll also talk about the TCloud system, which I'll go into detail about that here momentarily, but go over it and provide a demonstration for those that may not be familiar with it or would like to see a refresher on some things. have a couple of tasking order best practices for those that have used the tasking functionality to task the DESIS sensor. Just a couple of small things that hopefully will help improve tasking orders. Then Cara will talk about the DESIS data products that are offered, different options there are for DESIS data. Talk about the delivered data, what you get when you receive it. We'll also talk about on-orbit performance that has been observed and that we're constantly working to improve. And then once you get that DESIS data, what kind of processing options you have personally to kind of look and interpret that data for those that may like to see that. And then lastly, we'll talk about how you can request or go about getting access to performing the tasking or archive DESIS data ordering. So DESIS team, first, Jack Ickes, he's the senior VP here at Teledyne Brown, the geospatial solutions. So he's responsible for the overall geospatial side of Teledyne Brown, which of course encompasses MUSES and DESIS and the TCloud system that I mentioned. Yvonne, I'm sure everyone's familiar with her, the point of contact for DESIS data on the NASA side for Earth Science Data System. Cara, she's with Innovative Imaging and Research, one of our partners with this DESIS data. And she's a senior scientist and is the point of contact and definitely a resident expert on the image quality and instrument performance side of things. And then she'll have a part of this presentation where she'll go in depth with the DESIS data itself. And then there is myself, Heath Lester. I'm the payload operations manager for both onboard hardware and the ground system and the TCloud system. Additionally, you'll see acquisition coordinator there. There are certain situations and instances where people need to coordinate closely with us to acquire data, whether it's a coincident collect, things of that nature. You can definitely talk to me about that close coordination involved with that. So we'll talk a little bit about MUSES and DESIS. MUSES, for those that may not be aware, is our external platform. It's outside of station on Express Logistics Carrier number 4. It's a two gimbal axis platform that can host four what we call hosted payloads. It could be imaging sensor, it could be a space-borne exposure type payload, things of that nature, but we can fit what we call two large and two small hosted payloads at any one time. But then we also have the MUSES server, which is located internally. It's not necessarily a normal computer, but it's a Linux operating system computer that has good processing power, of course, and data storage. We have about 7 terabytes of data storage that helps us minimize the the external radiation hardened type memory that's needed outside of the space station. So one of the benefits with the MUSES platform and hosted payloads that are on there is that we can robotically install them. So all the bus systems and things that would be required for a satellite system and the non-operability of that as far as repairs or return, things of that nature, that's one of the benefits of our system. Data downlink standpoint, we can downlink around 225 gigabytes of data, imaging data, things of that nature a day. And then as well, as I mentioned with the server, we have onboard processing options. So if someone had process and they want to do build time off of data that's coming we could do that on the server as well. We have our point and control algorithms, which is a processing capability that helps us in our pointing for certain targets and acquiring that imagery. We advertise contract to launch less than 12 months for a hosted payload, a customer that wanted to put something on the MUSES platform. And as I kind of mentioned before, is for the benefits of a free flyer mission, one of the others is going to the MUSES platform is about a third of the cost of a free flyer satellite. The chart to the right just kind of provides some characteristics and performance of the MUSES platform. I won't go into great detail about that, but you can see some of those. And if you have any questions, we can address those a little bit later. So Earth Obs from the ISS. So it has, as with most things, a lot of pros and some cons. One of the benefits is, given the inclination of the ISS, would cover around 90% of the populated Earth, and that doesn't even count the ocean type targets that we might, or island type targets that we might acquire. We've collected Pacific garbage patch, things of that nature. So we cover a wide variety of the Earth, and it's as part of the challenge because of the ISS inclination. Anything above 55 degrees north latitude or 52 degrees south latitude, we cannot really reach. And one thing to keep in mind too, as far as the higher latitudes you go, the increased pointing that we have to do to reach that. So, but generally, most acquisitions that we take, we're able to get within a 25 degree off nadir angle. One of the other benefits too is we're able to acquire different areas of interest, or the same area of interest, at different times of the day. So allows for a BRDF type applications or diurnal dynamics. I mentioned this before, but we do provide the benefit of exchanging instruments, upgrading, repairing. A little bit cost up front to help with testing on something in the future. And then with the limited or reduced cost and able for us to provide the power, thermal, all those bus propulsion type systems, traditional barriers to entry are minimized. Additionally, along with the challenges with the ISS orbit, our revisit times are cyclical in nature. So that beep frequency has a lot to do with the latitude and time of year for station. So the DESIS imager itself, of course, is a hyperspectral imager, cooperative effort between us and DLR. First MUSES payload that we've had. We launched in June 2018. We have the commercial rights to the imagery, so we work arrangements with customers for commercial type applicability, and DLR retains the rights for scientific use. But then, of course, our arrangement with NASA and our collaboration there. Obviously, everyone here is very much interested in the scientific use of the hyperspectral data. So it is a DESIS has 235 bands with a 2.55 nanometer spectral resolution, of course, in the very near infrared, 400 to 1,000 nanometers. With ISS at a 400 kilometer orbit, it's a 30 meter GSD. And the mirror on DESIS, as you can kind of see in some of the schematics there to the right, it has a forward and a long track, a forward and an aft, and the long track of plus or minus 15 degrees, which we haven't really done much in this area yet, but it does offer the capability for BRDF and stereo acquisitions. We are still testing and working out the stereo acquisitions, and BRDF is still something that we would like to pursue as well. It is a push broom sensor, so we point and acquire as we go across. The max length strip of around 3,000 kilometers. That's kind of a software type limitation. And of course, 3,000 kilometers does build up a lot of data size. So we have to get that off the imager to free up the memory and things of that nature. So each strip is in 1024 by 1024 pixel tiles, or for ground reference, it's 30 by 30 kilometers or 900 square kilometers, roughly. Now, the ISS does fly slightly higher than 400 kilometers, so those sizes of the tiles are going to be a little bit larger than that. And again, another spreadsheet, this one with the DESIS specifications. Won't go into great detail reading through here, but if you have any questions about any of these specifications, we'll be glad to address them. One thing I will point out is that sun elevation angle is pretty big as far as processing the data, which I'm sure it is for the scientific side of things as well. But anything with a solar zenith angle of greater than 70 degrees, we cannot process to L2A, which is our full processing capability. And even not processed to L2A, we do have some, the data is not quite as good at lower sun elevation angles, but still processable and still get some data out of it. It's just the quality is slightly reduced. And you can see the different sun elevation angles or solar elevation, zenith angles, excuse me, there in that bottom row. Okay, so TCloud, which is our cloud-based data management and distribution system for geospatial imagery, specifically the DESIS data. On the front end, you have the user interface where you perform archive orders or tasking of the sensor, and then on the back end is the processing of that data and then the data delivery to the users. As I mentioned, allows the user to have an interface to, you know, look at what's in the archive, send, submit specific orders for tiles that we have in the archive, or task the sensor for new data or something that maybe not necessarily exists and meets the customer or the user's requirements. And we do can process and post-process in multiple ways. We have the current processors that we use, but the capability does exist to add additional checks or processing that that's not currently done today, but that flexibility is in the system. Okay, so now I'll quickly, I won't be able to go into great detail all the capabilities of TCloud demonstration of the TCloud system, the user interface specifically, but I'll touch on a couple of things real quick. So as you can see in the presentation, here is the login screen. And then back up. Have a guest login. So those that may not necessarily have an account yet, you could go in and see what's in our archive. You cannot order or specifically order any data or task the sensor without the correct permissions, but you can go in and see what is available in the archive. For those of you that do have an account, obviously you've probably logged in, or those that maybe soon to receive an account, we'll talk about and go through TCloud to kind of give an idea of what it's like. So once you log in, this is what you will see. I believe if I'm seeing it correctly, I'm showing the TCloud system to everyone. When you first log in, you'll have a pop-up here that comes up that kind of gives you some quick details if you're using a mouse or a mouse touchpad on the laptop. Kind of gives you some navigation instructions to what to do to move around on the globe and things like that. I'll start at the top and just kind of go through the systems. We do have a search function, so you can search for a city or a Latin long or a landmark, and it will take you there. Of course, if you ever get a point off the map and you just kind of want to recenter yourself, we have this home button that will kind of take it back to the place where you first started. And then you can view on a three-dimensional or a flat map. So different views for user preference. We also have different MUSES, maps and imagery, base maps. So if you have particular preference of how you like to see the base map in the system, we do have different ones there. And then this question mark is just the pop-up that was there at the beginning when you come up. If you do have, you get to a point, I'll show this here momentarily. If you get a bunch of different pop-up windows up that show, you know, your search results, order history, things like that, you get a bunch of pop-ups, but you want to see the map closely, you can use this hide all forms button right here, and it will kind of move everything to the side, and you can click it again, and it will bring those back up for you. Here, our order cart, we'll touch on that here shortly. This is where you'll go in and proceed with any orders, tiles, or taskings that you've added to the system. And then order history, anything that you place will show up here. This is where you can see what you've submitted in the past and also retrieve data from orders that you do have in the system, whether it's archive or tasking the sensor. And then you just have the standard kind of user pull down menu that I invite everyone to. One, if you have questions about the system or issues, you can click this contact us button, and we'll be happy to help with any concerns or issues that you have. And then here in the Help Center, has a lot of good documentation that shows instructions on how to perform different functions, whether it's ordering data or looking at specific functions or just pretty much anything. You can go in there and search what you're looking for, and we have videos and documentation that will help with all that. But again, if anyone has any specific questions that they can't find or just, you know, want to come straight to us, just go ahead and click that contact us button and feel free to ask away, and we'll be glad to help. All right, so we'll get more into the good details here. So if you had a particular AOI that you wanted to go for, you have a few different options of doing that AOI. You can draw the AOI. This is a little pencil here, where you can go anywhere on the map, really, and just draw your AOI. And when you get ready, double click, and it will show you what we have there. Additionally, that you could enter here at the bottom, you can enter your coordinates and the area. I'll just do that same area, 35, 35, 6, and say I wanted 300 square kilometers. It can take you there. And then when you want to see what's there, you just double click in the window and it'll bring up the tiles that are there. Close this out again. If you want to, I should have explained this before, but if you want to, when you have search results up and you want to get rid of it and select the different AOI or change your specifications, you can just click this X button for clear AOI, and it'll clear what you have in the system. Another option we have is importing an AOI, which you can import from a single file, so a KML, KMZ, or a zip file containing a shapefile set. Or you can import from a file set that has all of your shape file set in individual files. You can choose a file, and it'll allow you to put each one of those in for importing your AOI. Okay, so we'll stay here. I'll draw another AOI. Don't have a specific reason for using Oklahoma, but using it here. So when you do draw it, your search results will come up with everything that we have in that area. In the search results window, you can sort by any of these metadata entries in here. You can see we have center point, lat, and longitude, cloud coverage. You can sort on any of those things and kind of help you out, or you can filter acquisition date between certain dates, quality rating, any of those things, cloud cover percentage. You can sort, say you didn't want anything above what we've classified as 50% cloud cover. Let's uncheck everything after that, and it'll only show you what is above or below that value. So once you have this up, you have different options. If you find something that you wanted to order from the product list, you would just check. Say that's the one you wanted, and you could add it to the cart. And you can see in your order cart, it goes to one. If you have multiple, you can select all of these and take this out. And then you can select this cart at the top, and it'll add everything that you've selected into the order cart, so you don't have to go through individually and do it. Let's just say we wanted to do all those, and that's what we wanted to order. Once you do go into the order cart, you have all your items here. If you wanted to process to L2A, which is where you select your output product type, if you wanted them all to be that way, you can select L2A. And it'll change them all to L2A. If you wanted one of them to be all three levels, you can select that, and you can see it as the product type for those tiles at those three levels. So multiple options for the processing levels, different ones for different tiles. And then once you've made the changes that you want as far as selecting output product type, you just check out and put an order name so you can identify it in your order history. And then we do have post-processing options that we'll touch on a little bit more in the chart, but we have some different options. The defaults are generally recommended for best, but we do have other options. And then additionally, for order catalogs, if you wanted to clip specifically to the AOI that you have drawn, here is where you would select that. So it would clip the tiles to specifically to your AOI, so you just receive that data. So back in this area, let's say we wanted to task this whole area. The easiest thing here is at the end, on under coverage area, under that same search results window, you have an entire AOI. We do have other options for uncovered areas that are defined within the AOI, or the entire uncovered AOI, or like I said, the entire AOI. If you wanted to do the entire AOI, which I believe most usually do, we go into order cart. You can see it's added a tasking for us. You can select the processing level. For some reason I only have L1B, but you would see the L1C and L2A as well. Sensor parameters, there's nothing to change here. Those are all by default, but the tasking parameters are what is the main thing to fill out for you in these taskings. Description, of course, just to kind of put whatever you feel is necessary for you in your description of the tasking parameters. Not necessarily anything we use, but helps for organizing whatever orders that you have. Date range for collection, and this will go into my best practices pitch a little bit in just a few minutes, but the longer that you can set the collection range, the better it is, obviously, for a successful execution. In short, as long as you select a window, and when we get to the point, you'll see this momentarily, it shows feasible. In theory and technically, we could collect it, but if it's a window for 1 to 2 weeks, we may have one or two opportunities depending on where it falls into the revisit window, if you will. So a feasibility assessment doesn't necessarily take into account cloud cover and ISS dynamic events that may happen. So in short, the longer you can make the window and as long as you're able to accept it, the best to be able to successfully complete. And then you would have the max cloud cover percentage you're willing to accept. Given how cloud cover can be a bit ambiguous, we have a range that we classify tiles, obviously clear and 100% is pretty straightforward. But in between, we have ranges to be able to classify. So I think visual inspection obviously is always the best to see if the cloud cover is going to impact whatever you're trying to get from the data. Offnator angle, we default to 25 degrees. We do have the capability to go up to 45 degrees. I find most users don't want that type of angle, just skewing the data or whatnot, but we do have that capability. And again, at the higher latitudes, sometimes we have to maybe go to that level to get to something if it's a high enough latitude. Sun elevation angle, we default to a minimum of 20 degrees. Like I mentioned, we cannot process L2A below 20 degrees. So that is the default minimum. And then, of course, the higher the minimum sun elevation is, the better the data quality. But still, at the lower, you get good data. And then we also have a reoccurrence function where you can set the interval where it's recurring every X number of days, which we will do our best to try to adhere to whatever that constraint is. But unfortunately, we're at the mercy of the orbit. So sometimes it may be a little more or less, definitely depending on where it falls under the revisit range for that AOI. And then we also have a standing, which, as it probably states, or probably is pretty straightforward. Standing, anytime we pass over it, we're going to do our best to collect it. So those are the few options there. So just going to real quick in here, range. And then once you've got those entered, you'll do a feasibility report. And what this does is communicates all the parameters that you've requested for the tasking of the sensor back to our planning system, and it looks over the date range that you've provided for the AOI, and taking ISS ephemeris into account and determining the different overpass opportunities that there will be. Now, the return is just to tell you that, yes, it is feasible to collect your AOI in the time range you've selected, but it doesn't provide when that would happen. So this is just one to make sure what you're submitting is feasible from the start, of course. So as you can see, it does take a few seconds, and it provides a little information back, and you can see here in the feasibility it says feasible. So your order should be good to go at this point. If it were to come back not feasible, you wouldn't really be able to check out because we don't obviously want to have a infeasible order, or don't want to give you a false hope that we could get the order if it's not really feasible. So if it comes back not feasible, it's more than likely the time frame of the AOI, or it's potentially the offnator, depending on the how high the latitude is and things of that nature. If you're ever getting to a point where you're submitting a tasking order and just you can't seem to figure out why it's not being feasible, please reach out to us. Don't hesitate. I can research, or we can research to let you know what the issue is and what you may be able to change to in order to have it feasible. But I think for the most part, a lot of tasking results, I don't think people have had a whole lot of issues. But if any of you out there have, please don't hesitate to let us know, and we can try to work out what the problem is. So whenever you're ready, we just do a checkout. And again, it's like the archive order. Your name. This is for order. Sorry, one second. So that's one thing to keep in mind is I have one tasking and seven catalog orders in here. So if you did a checkout, it would try to check out all of it at one time. So if you just wanted to get rid of everything in here, you could clear, and then you're left with your tasking. But again, like I said, it's much like the archive order, order name, order description. If you'd like, do a test preview order, and it'll give you the information that you've put in. Give you the, obviously I have a very large AOI here, 38,000 square kilometers, but then you would place your order, and it would be our system for collection. Once you did submit that order, we did plan something, you would start getting notifications that data has been received, and then also let you know when data is available. And in that case, you can come back under your order history that I mentioned earlier. And if you had an order in here, you could download the order. And you can see all the different orders collected for it, download it, and go back and see the details of your order. You can zoom to the AOI and highlight and things like that. Just real quick, because I'm running out a little bit of time, but I wanted to touch on a couple things in here that I think will become useful for many. Let's say this AOI here, you're not necessarily interested in tasking the sensor, but you wanted to know if data is going to come in at any time on there, or even if you did submit the tasking request. You can take and a couple of things. One, if you want to create this specific search whenever you come back in, you can save the search and it'll bring it up for you quickly instead of having to draw the AOI and selecting everything again. So you can save it off, give it a name, and whether it's public or not. So of course, if it's public, anyone that comes in and looks at the search, name searches that are saved out there would be able to see yours. If you did not want to have it out there for others to see, you can uncheck public and only you would see it. Now it'll be mixed in with all the other public, but only you would be able to see the one that you've created. As part of that as well, I'll go ahead and jump down here real quick. If you also wanted to limit that data to, I'll reset my filters here. You can select the filters in a histogram for acquisition date, solar zenith, or solar azimuth. Those are some of the metadata available to filter on. Let's say you had an acquisition date and solar zenith angle. You can take and set minimum time, you know, no data before this particular time, and it will update also your search results for that data. And then also for an azimuth, let's say that. Well, when you save this name search, that information will be saved as well. So only data matching that will show up for you. In addition, you can create a notification topic. So what will happen is if you create this for this AOI here, anytime data comes in for that particular AOI, or obviously DESIS products, you'll be notified that some new data has come in and you can go look to see what that may be. So yeah, I think those were the highlights that I wanted to hit. We're limited on time and I need to turn it over to Kara here pretty soon to talk about the actual DESIS products, but at the end if we have time, or even after if anyone wants to talk to me about some more information on TCloud, I'll be glad to assist anyone. And again, we have the help center out there that should help with a lot of questions. But again, if you want to come straight to us, that is not an issue, and we'll be glad to field any questions you can or that we can, whether it's through my personal email or this contact us button right here. So with that, I will hand it over to Kara.
Thanks, Heath. Are you going to be still on? Because we have a couple of questions in the chat around tasking that I think you can touch on.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'll be here as long as y'all need me. I guess I need to give it to Kara.
Okay, I've taken control, I believe. And hopefully everyone can see my screen.
Perfect.
So, okay, great. So thank you, Heath. As he mentioned, I'm the technical point of contact for DESIS. So today I'm going to take some time. I'm going to go over the available DESIS data products that are out there, what you can expect from a DESIS data delivery. I'm going to touch on some of our on-orbit performance assessments and evaluations, and then I'm going to give you a few considerations about data processing at the end. So I have a lot to cover. I'm going to do it kind of fast. I apologize. So to start, once DESIS data is acquired by the sensor, it's processed to a level 1A raw data set, and that's what's actually stored in TCloud in the archive. Processing to any higher level products only occurs when one of you comes in and orders the data from the archive. And you can order the data processed up to a level 1B radiance, a level 1C orthorectified radiance, or a level 2A surface reflectance product. The level 1B radiance product is a top of atmosphere radiance product. It's still in sensor orientation. It's had the radiometric corrections applied, including nonlinearity and dark current and radiometric corrections. And the sensor corrections have been applied. So defect pixels have been corrected, the rolling shutter and spectral smile corrections have been applied, and a striping correction has been applied to the data. When the data is processed to level 1B, there's quality information that's generated identifying the location of any defect or suspect pixels in any band in the image. So on the right-hand side of the screen, I've got an example image. This is a data set that was acquired over San Joaquin River Delta in August of 2019. You can see it's in sensor orientation, and it actually illustrates one of the things that it's a quirk of acquiring data off the space station. Because of the inclination angle of the space station, it's not sun synchronous. We're actually acquiring data on both sides of the orbit. So occasionally you'll get data sets like this one that are rotated 180 degrees from how you would expect. In this case, north is to your lower right. So it's just something to keep in mind if you choose to work with level 1B data. The next product is the level 1C data set. This is an orthorectified top of atmosphere radiance product. The sensor distortion has been removed, and an on-the-fly image matching algorithm using high geometric accuracy reference images is applied to orthorectify the data. If the image matching can't be used for some reason, either because the land cover is too uniform or the snow cover or cloud cover, then the image is corrected using just the onboard position and attitude information and the estimated bore sight angles. You also get quality information with the level 1C product. It's the same as with the level 1B, but rotated to match the orientation of the level 1C data set. So you see in our example now, it's the same acquisition from the previous slide, only now we're map oriented. The level 2A surface reflectance product is an atmospherically corrected surface reflectance. The top of atmosphere radiance has been corrected for atmospheric effects, including molecular absorption, scattering, and aerosols. Modtran is used to generate the radiative transfer lookup tables that are used in the correction. And it's corrected using either a rugged terrain or a flat terrain algorithm. In addition to the quality information with the defect and suspect pixels, with the level 2A data, you also get additional quality information, including a per pixel land cover classification, aerosol optical thickness map, and a water vapor map. So in our image example on the right, you can see it looks similar, but the colors are a little bit more vivid now because we have corrected out the atmosphere. There's several additional product options that are available when you're ordering data. You can specify the binning that you would like the data to be delivered with. You can get it at full resolution, which is the 2.55 nanometer spectral resolution data set. But you can also get it binned to a 5.1 nanometer product, a 7.65 nanometer product, or a 10.2 nanometer spectral resolution product. If you order orthorectified data, so the level 1C or the level 2A, you can specify the map projection that gets used, and you can also specify what resampling algorithm you want applied to the data. And then for the level 2A data, you can decide whether you want the rugged terrain or the flat terrain algorithm, and then you can specify an ozone column value that gets used in the atmospheric correction. And when you order data and it's delivered, it's going to be delivered either through a direct download from the TCloud repository, or you can request that it be delivered to an AWS S3 bucket. Every product and tile that you order is going to be delivered as a separate zip file. And if you're ordering directly from the TCloud, you're gonna get an email from the system when the data is ready for you to download it. That email is gonna have a link that brings you back to TCloud, allows you to just directly download it, like it shows in the lower right image. Or as Heath was saying, you can go back into your order history in TCloud and order directly from there. Your delivered files, each zip file is going to contain a series of subfiles. I'm going to go over each one in more detail over the next few slides. You can expect your data volumes to be for full resolution around 400 to 600 megabytes per zip file. If you get binned data sets, it's going to be smaller. I have, for example, a 10.2 nanometer binned example is on the order of 1 to 200 megabytes per zip file. On the right, I show all of the files you would expect to receive for a given product and tile ordered. And I give a breakdown of the file naming convention. There's some helpful information that's embedded in the file names, including the product level. So this is a level 2A example. The acquisition date and time are embedded in the file names. And then the processor that was used to generate the data set is also included in the file names here. So going through each one of those files to give you a little bit more information, starting with the quick look image, this is the ql_image.tiff. It's a 3-band 8-bit image. It's kind of like an RGB. The bands aren't quite right for an RGB image, but the band information is extracted from the hyperspectral image and then stretched out to an 8-bit image for easy display. It lets you look at it in standard software like Windows Photo Viewer or Paint even. Just to get an idea about what the data set looks like, but from the quick look, you can't get back to the real hyperspectral information. Our example over here on the right shows the quick look image for an acquisition over Lake Erie in August of 2019. The metadata file, this is the metadata.xml file, contains all of the information about the sensor and the acquisition and any processing that was applied to the data set. This is where you're going to find your image corner coordinates, acquisition times, geometry information, and there's a lot of spectral band information that's included in the metadata file that's important. It's text file with some capability. If you open it in something like Internet Explorer, you have a little more functionality and control over the file, but you can just use a text editor to open it. And there's detailed descriptions of this, all of the metadata fields included in the DSIS data product specification document that we've got linked here. It's on the Teledyne Brown website. Just briefly, the file does have a lot of useful information, so I kind of wanted to point out where you would find some of it. So starting at the top of the file, there's some general file information followed by processing parameters. This is where you might see like the resampling that was applied to your imagery. In this case, I've got bilinear interpolation. The base parameters section is where you're going to find information about the location of the acquisition and the time of acquisition. Location is stored in the bounding polygon coordinates section. It's going to have each corner coordinate and a center point. And your acquisition date and time are stored here in the temporal coverage section. The specific parameters section includes information about the sensor, the orbit, like in this case, we were on the descending side of the orbit. There's additional product dependent information included here. So if it's an orthorectified product, there'll be additional information about the orthorectification. for a surface reflectance product. There will be some atmospheric correction information included here. And at the bottom is where we find the solar and center geometry information, the azimuths and the elevation angles. Now, there's the spectral band characteristics are stored in this section. It's a fairly large block of information. So I just want to kind of go over what you would expect to find in there. For every band in your hyperspectral image, you're going to get this block of information. So I'm just showing one here. This is for band number 10. First thing you're going to get is the center wavelength of the band in nanometers. We also give you the full width half maximum of the band in nanometers. You get a full spectral response for that band. Here are the wavelength values and then the corresponding response values for the spectral response. And then underneath are the gain and offset for that band. These values are required to convert your hyperspectral imagery to radiance or reflectance. It's fairly straightforward when you're working with reflectance data. They're constant. It's a constant gain and a constant offset for every band and every image. But when you're working with radiance data, these values do change from band to band and image to image. So it's important to know where to find them in the metadata file and then how to apply them, which I'm going to touch on at the very end of this these slides. And then the last thing is the percent dead or suspicious pixels to give you an idea about the quality of the data set. But then for that, there's also a quality file, which is the ql_quality.tiff. It's an 8-bit TIFF file with the same number of layers as your hyperspectral image. And each bit in this file represents a different quality issue. So I've got a table on the lower left that lays out which bit corresponds to what quality issue. So during processing, if a quality issue was identified in a specific band, that bit would be set to 1. If no quality issues are found, then the bits are left all set to 0. So I've got two quick examples to show how it's used. This is from our Lake Erie image. You can see the main section, and this is band 7. The main section of the image has a quality value of 0, so there's no issues there. The area surrounding my image has a quality value of 16, which would be my fourth bit being set, indicating there's no data there, which makes sense. It's, you know, just fill values. But along this lower left side of the image, we do have a quality value set to 32. This is the fifth bit being set, indicating a manufacturing defect. Now, DESIS does have a documented manufacturing defect that affects the first 7 bands of the image. And so this is how you would use the quality file to determine which pixels in your image are affected by the manufacturing defect. The second example I have is from band 50. For the most part, there's no issues, no data surrounding it. But in this case, we have one little strip of pixels running through with the quality value of 1. This indicates that there is a dead detector on the sensor. So this is how we communicate that information to you. If you order level 2A data, you're also going to get a second quality file. This would be the ql_quality-2 TIFF file. This is also an 8-bit TIFF file, but this one only has 10 bands. The first 8 bands are a land cover classification. Each layer represents a different land cover, which I show right here. And if that land cover is detected, the bit gets set to 1. Otherwise, it's left at 0. The 9th layer is the aerosol optical depth that was found during atmospheric correction. This value is scaled by 100 to store in this file. So you have to divide by 100 to get back to the aerosol optical depths. And the water vapor is stored in the 10th layer of this file. And these are scaled by a strange number. They're scaled by 42 to take full advantage of the bit depth of the file. So if you want to look at these values, remember that you have to divide by 42 to get back to the water vapor values determined during atmospheric correction. So a few ancillary files. There's an ENVI header file, makes the data much easier to work with in ENVI, and a product history file that gives you some information about what processing was applied to the data. And then there's the hyperspectral image itself. This would be the spectral_image.tiff. It's going to be your largest file in the delivery. It's a 16-bit TIFF file with a separate layer for every hyperspectral band. And as I mentioned, it's stored as DN. It has to be combined with the gains and the offsets from the metadata file to convert it to radiance or reflectance. You're going to need specialized software to look at and fully exploit this data. You're going to need something like ENVI or Imagine or MATLAB or Python to work with it. So on the right, we've got an example. This is still the Lake Erie image that I was showing before. This is just three of the bands from it. So you can do this. You can look at individual bands, or you can look at the spectral information that's included in the image. You can see my blue dot is out over the water that corresponds to a water reflectance spectra here. It's the blue line on my figure. And then the red dot is in some healthy vegetation. And so you've got this red line corresponds to it. This is a nice vegetation spectra that was pulled from the hyperspectral image. So I'm going to briefly go over some of our on-orbit performance assessments. This is something that is being continually evaluated by both I2R and DLR. We've been looking at the radiometric, geometric, and spatial performance of the system since launch. We published a detailed description of our methods and assessments and results in 2019. So I've included that reference there if you'd like to go look it up for more information. But since then, we have been updating our results. There was a paper presented in 2020 that published some of our updated results. So I've included that reference there as well. But starting with the radiometric accuracy, we have performed a vicarious calibration of DESIS. We use several methods. We've compared DESIS data to ground truth, and we do a cross calibration with other satellite sensors. And due to our continual evaluation of the sensor, DLR did update the radiometric calibration tables for DESIS in May of 2020. This was a release with the processor version 2.10. So if you see V210 in your file names, you've got the updated radiometric calibration tables in your imagery. Also, important thing to note is that DLR is currently working on another update to the radiometric calibration. This is going to be an acquisition date dependent calibration, and we're in process of putting that together, and we expect to have more information about that release very soon. So do stay tuned for more information about the radiometric calibration update that we're planning. But for the version 2.10 update from May, we did a comparison to ground truth. We looked at several RadCalNet sites and compared DESIS to top of atmosphere reflectance from those RadCalNet sites. We looked at Railroad Valley and Le Crau, France. And what we found is that DESIS compared within 10% of the RadCalNet data when we performed this assessment. The dashed lines on this figure represent, the plus or minus 10% lines. And you can see we're for the most part, we're within 10%, except for some atmospheric absorption features. We got the ozone band and the water vapor bands. And Le Crau had some larger errors here in the lower wavelengths. But for the most part, within 10%. We also performed the cross calibration with other satellite sensors. We used Landsat 8 and Sentinel 2. We used looked for near coincident acquisitions over spectrally smooth sites where both sensors were within an hour of each other and with low view zenith angles. So we had 3 Landsat 8 acquisitions for this and 7 Sentinel 2 acquisitions that we used. And we converted everything to top of atmosphere reflectance and compared the data. We band integrated DESIS before comparing. So here are those results. The Landsat comparison is on the top and the Sentinel-2 comparison is on the bottom figure. Looking at the Landsat data, in the longer wavelengths, we're within 5%. I think DESIS was always greater than Landsat for this comparison. We see some slightly larger errors here in the shorter wavelengths, but we're still within 10% of Landsat. For Sentinel-2, we have a slightly more consistent spread in all of the data sets. But again, in the longer wavelengths, we're within 5% of Sentinel-2, plus or minus 5% in this case. And in the shorter wavelengths, we have some larger errors, but we're still well within 10% with Sentinel-2. For the geometric accuracy and the spatial resolution, we looked at 177 scenes to assess geolocational accuracy. What we found is that when we use the image matching technique, our errors are very small. We're within a pixel, about 21 meters in both the northern and easting directions. If image matching is not used to correct the data, however, our errors are much larger. So they're on the order of 300 meters in the across track and about 500 meters in the along track. For spatial resolution, we estimated the MTF at Nyquist. Unfortunately, we have limited targets that we can use for this assessment due to the inclination of the space station orbit and the ground sample distance of DESIS. There just aren't a lot of edge large uniform edge targets at that angle that we need to perform this assessment. So to date, we've only gotten some initial cross-track MTF estimates that exceed 0.3, so we're pretty pleased with that. We expect that the in-track estimates or measurements will be a little bit lower, but still we're happy with the spatial performance of the system. So now really briefly, I'm going to touch on some data processing considerations. As I mentioned, you're going to need specialized software to work with the data to fully exploit the geometric and spectral properties of the hyperspectral imagery. So, you know, some of the ones that I've run across, by no means an exhaustive list, are going to be ENVI, ERDOS, or, you know, programming software with enough image processing capability like MATLAB or Python. You're going to need these types of software packages to convert the data sets to radiance reflectance. It's something that I've mentioned several times while I was talking, and I just want to go over quickly how to do that because it is an important step in your data processing chain. The gains and offsets from the metadata are applied to either convert level 1B and level 1C data to radiance or the level 2A data to reflectance. The conversion is the same in both cases. It's a whole band conversion. The gain for a band is applied to all of the pixels within that band and then added to the offset. And that will get you to either radiance or reflectance. But you need to know where those values are and pull them out of the metadata. If you're working with ENVI, however, it's a little bit easier. The ENVI header file that we include with each DSIS image does include those gains and offsets, and ENVI does have a built-in tool that will read them and apply them for you. So I did want to point that out, that it's a fairly straightforward process using ENVI. And so now I just want to turn it over to Yvonne for a few minutes to talk about how to access DSIS data.
Thanks, everyone. So I just wanted to add this slide to the presentation just so everyone knows how to access DSIS data. And so once you receive this, in order to gain access, we ask you to submit through a form. And again, you'll get this deck after the meeting where you'll actually have the link to the form, as well as you can check out our commercial small sat acquisition program website on Earth Data, where the form is also available. So with that, I know we're kind of tight on time. I just want to open it up to questions right now. Thank you, Heath and Kara, for being able to answer many of the questions in the chat. But I will unmute folks so that feel free to ask any questions you might have.
Hi there.
Yep, we can hear you.
Oh, sorry. I was wondering if there's any costs associated when tasking for DSIS data under an interagency agreement.
Great question. So currently, if you are either a NASA or US government-funded researcher, and you submitted the form to request DSIS data, there's no cost for tasking.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Hello, I do have questions. So is the level 2A already available to download? Because I remember last year in the summer, it was still 1C maximum. Thank you.
Yes, the level 2A has been released and is available to download.
Perfect, thanks.
Okay, I don't know if there are any other questions, but I'm just, while we wait, I'm going to put it on a last slide with just some of our contact information and a few extra links here for more information.
One more question. Will we have access to these presentations?
Yes, I will send that out directly after this call.
Awesome. Thank you.